everybody, and welcome back for more Disco Elysium. In the last stream, we explored the shipyard a little bit, found a very chatty dock worker who let us know that Elizabeth, the lawyer for the Hardy Boys, is actually Everard's right hand. And then we had a conversation with Everard that didn't go very well, didn't go in our favor at all. But after that, I was an idiot and couldn't figure out how to get out of his room. I thought the game had glitched, reloaded, so we're beginning with a little bit of a deja vu on this stream, because I did set up the character a little bit better to handle some of what Everard has to offer at the skill level I have, because until we talk with him, we can't get out of the dockyard. So we're going to see if we do any better than we did last time. Here's hoping.
Before you is a walrus of a man, seated behind a large desk. He looks up from his work, not the least bit surprised to see you. With great effort, he straightens himself up in his chair, yet says nothing. He simply stares at you.
Yeah, let's get to business.
Welcome, Mr. Dubois, Mr. Kitsuragi. It's good of you two to stop by. Please, have a seat.
Yeah.
I'm Everard, yeah. Everard Clare, head of the Debardes Union here in Martinez.
Yeah, we'll see if we can get away with not sitting in that chair this time. That
I'd
was
offer
painful.
You my hand, but unfortunately my health prevents me from getting up. You understand?
Yes,
he
your
looks
health.
Extremely comfortable. The tiny folding chair, on the other hand, looks like a torture device.
I don't trust a single word this guy has to say.
You go ahead, detective.
Whatever he has in store for you, it can't be good, he thinks. I'll do my best.
Mm-hmm.
Forget about that. What's with this Dubois stuff? You're getting some seriously bad vibes from that name.
I'm just going to try and avoid the whole Dubois thing this time around. See if that gets me any better. Yeah, but I'd rather stand. That chair looks
Please,
awful.
Mr. Dubois, let us converse in a civilized manner, as equals. Take a seat. I insist.
I don't sit. It's kind of my thing.
Very well, Mr. Dubois. I respect a man with strong convictions.
As he nods, his multiple chins move like ocean waves.
I, too, have convictions. One of which is that I will not engage with any man who won't face me at eye level. Should you find yourself more amenable in the future, I'd gladly resume our conversation. But until then, I'm afraid I must ask you to leave.
You're no Titan of Volition, buddy. He's got you in a fork.
Fuck.
Sit down or leave.
Oh, well.
Excellent, Mr. Dubois.
Fucking Volition.
I can see that you're a reasonable man and reasonable men. Reasonable men can be of great use to one another.
He gives you a sly wink. Remain serious.
So tell me, how can the head of the Debardes Union help a representative of the Revachol Citizens Militia today?
The chair you're sitting on has got to be the most uncomfortable
Ow.
Chair in the world. It's violating your backside.
Oh, by the way, I heard you got a rather
Not in the
rude
fun
reception
way.
From a certain Lawrence Gart. Some people have no manners, it pains me to say.
It is creepy how well in tune with this city this man is.
This should take care of that nonsense.
Points to a giant novelty check in his desk. It's absolutely comically huge. I didn't take the bribe before, I'm not taking it this time.
It should be sufficient to cover your expenses for a few days and patch over your differences with a cafeteria manager. Go ahead, take it.
He points at it again.
Wow, that's 25 real. That's good money. You need it.
I already paid for my room for the day.
Yes, but you owe him for it.
Keep it. I'm good. We'll go for the guard first.
Yes, I know, Lawrence. He's a real character. No union man in him. A real piece of work, that boy is.
True capitalist.
With a grin, he points to the checker game. It's like you're on a game show. At least don't thank him for it.
Okay, okay. I respect a man with principles. No handouts, then.
He crosses his arms on his ample midsection and sinks further into his chair.
I'd like to set your mind at ease about one other matter. Your lost gun. Let me assure you, union people are on it as we speak. I've got my best hounds looking for that lost gun.
His slug-like lips move, but all you hear is an echo. Lost gun, lost gun, lost gun. The world is swallowed by a black hole of fear. Only two words escape its gravitational pull. Lost and gun.
Thank you, Half-Light.
When he said, don't worry, he actually meant, be very worried.
I'm not worried. I got this.
Are you all right, Harry? You say you got this, but you seem a little anxious to me. Don't be. Everything's going to be all right. It's not like you left it loaded. You didn't lose a loaded gun. Local children aren't out there playing with it right now, pointing it into their own mouths. It's in a safe place. I just know it. I have a feeling everything's going to be all right.
It was loaded. There were two bullets in it. You always keep at least two barrels loaded.
Fuck. Yeah, I'm not gonna chance it this time. Trying to play it a little bit cooler than the composure break that Harry had in the last stream.
Officer, we will deal with this later. We don't need Mr. Clare's help with this.
I wouldn't be so sure about that.
Fuck. Okay.
God, you're sweating. Your knee is jerking. You're about to cry, aren't you? You're about to cry because you lost your gun and those children are gonna shoot themselves with it.
No, I'm not about to cry!
Mr. Dubois, you don't look so good.
Stop calling me Harry Dubois! I am not the husband of Blanche! Only gay people and old people will get that reference.
What is this, Mr. Dubois, he keeps repeating? What is he trying to pull here? You need to cool the fuck down. Chill.
Mr. Dubois! Mr. Dubois! Harry!
Large man snaps his fingers, but it has no effect. You're in some stupor. There are no Harrys. Let your mind go to your soft place. Sure, let's try that.
While Everard is distracted by your odd behavior, the lieutenant's eyes are mapping everything around you. The folder, desk, papers on the wall.
Mr. Dubois, are you okay? Can I get you a glass of water or something? Are you having some kind of medical emergency?
Maybe you could use your hands somehow, in a kind of throw-in motion, like you're throwing that Mr. Dubois act right back at him. He's Mr. Dubois.
Nah, I'm as good as it gets, Mr. Dubois. Oh yeah, man, I'm fucking great. Keep sliding. Yeah, I did that last time. It was not what the answer I thought it was. Actually, this chair is uncomfortable. I could use that glass of water. Sit upright. I'm melting! Melting! What a world! Sure, let's go with what composure wants us to do.
Don't be dramatic. I can see your condition isn't terminal.
What an odd demonstration of... you got me, Harry. I don't even know what. As entertaining as it was, I'm afraid we're wasting our time. And I'm an extremely busy man, as I'm sure you are too.
Okay, enough. We are here to ask you some questions pertaining to a murder investigation.
Quick, here's your window. Get yourself together and ask him questions. Police officer questions. It is about time to stop embarrassing yourself. Questions will help you regain some of your lost dignity.
Just a little bit, yeah. So aren't you gonna ask me how I got in?
Harry, honestly, I'm just relieved you didn't get a hernia. A man your age?
Man my age? What are you implying? I'm at the peak of my physical abilities. I, too, am surprised by the resilience and athleticism of this tool I've been provided with. Taps your chest. My body's gonna break down any moment now. Probably push it to the limit. Enough wackiness. Let's get back to business. That's too boring to say nothing. We're gonna go bravado again.
Yes, yes, Harry. You are obviously in peak physical condition, and I salute both your initiative and your physical prowess. Very impressive, Harry. Very impressive.
Thank you.
Anyway, I assure you, I am a very well-informed man. Information reaches me before I even get the chance to request it.
Well, I want to talk to you about this hanging.
Oh, of course. That's your main thing here. That's why you're in Martin Ames.
It is the main
thing. I know everything that goes on around here, and I would love to discuss it with you.
Good!
I mean, it's no secret that the lynching is connected to the strike. So much to talk about. Honestly, it's been weighing on me so heavily. I understand you need to interview me.
I sense there's a but.
But there's a thing that's been keeping me up at night. I want to talk about the hanging. I mean, if we could just calmly talk, exchange information, we could blow this thing wide open.
Yes, that sounds good. Let's do that.
But I can't think straight with this thing weighing on me. You're police officers, aren't you? I have a crazy idea. You guys are basically door-opening machines, incredibly talented at opening doors.
Well, I have opened a few doors in my life, yeah,
and
sure.
I'm sure you're going to open this one with flying colors, Harry. This really is very simple, and there's nothing shady about it.
Really?
An excellent opportunity presents itself, sire. You could win the trust of the Archliar, pretend to play into his hand. Then, should you wish, bend his efforts towards your own.
All right, I'll bite. Whose door is it?
Oh, no one's. It's just a weasel. A weasel lives there. Nothing for you to worry about.
What do you mean by weasel, Everard?
A loud blabbering weasel. When weasels feel no one is watching, they start acting foolishly.
He removes his glasses and rubs his nose.
Just go there, unlock the door, and leave it open. It's been such a burden on me, Harry. I just want this to be over so I can discuss business with you.
Damn it, fine. I'll look into it. We need to talk about that murder, after all.
Fantastic, my friend. Just let me know when it's done and we can take our friendship to the next level.
He flicks his fingers.
You can get the key from Manana. He's down by the gates. Manana's like a free agent in the Union. Special operations. Hardened socialist. A real free thinker, too. He'll tell you precisely where the door is. One last thing, Harry. Just open the door. You don't need to go in or anything. I just want that weasel to come home and see the unlocked door.
So yeah, what is that container that's outside your office?
My dear Harry, there are literally millions of containers in this harbor. I couldn't possibly remember what's in all of them.
There was something special about it. It was attached to the Kvalsund crane.
Harry, you smooth-talking son of a bitch. Time is a precious resource, and I don't have enough of it to count containers with you.
Smooth-talking? Maybe that's the way to go about opening the container. You should at least try convincing it.
I did try rhetoric, but my rhetoric is too low. It's still don't know what this means, but what the hell. I'm looking into your shady brew. Throw you off a bit.
I don't know what that means, Harry. Shady brew? There are so many moving parts in my operation, I can't keep track of them all.
Maybe it means the special... He's trying to mean the special borscht?
You know what? Don't even tell me. Whatever it is, do it. Surprise me. Just one thing. If you can, make it even shadier.
Oh, it's the shadiest. Just like you, Mr. Clare.
He sincerely has no idea what you were talking about. And he doesn't care either.
I'm told that the union is involved in the local drug trade.
What? Harry, how could you say that to me? You know I appreciate a joke as much as any jolly fat guy, but I can't take slander. Are you actually investigating this?
The reaction appears to be sincere, but it's impossible to tell with this guy, honestly.
No, I'm not.
You've hurt me, Harry. Me, a friend. But you know what?
He perks up.
I trust you, like I trust all my friends. And I know you'll never talk to me about this again, because you don't want to wound me. So do what you want, and let's change the subject.
He's hiding his real reaction beneath courtesy.
Yeah, he's a little bit squirmy about that.
Thank you for your understanding. We will continue to do what we must.
You too, Lieutenant. You know, I like you, but you never were my favorite. I'm a Harry guy. I'm Team Harry.
Well, Harry is kind of my favorite too.
I'm taken. Do we have anything else to do here, Harry?
Although Kim really is, like, the best partner this guy could have ever hoped to ask for. This is the only one I don't really want to talk to him about. There was a role in here I want to see if I can get. So...
Wait. You need this to get in and out through the gate.
Reaches into his drawer and pulls out a plastic card. Thanks, I guess. I was wondering how I was supposed to get out.
Here, you're one of us now. A real red and white union man. Take care, Harry.
Actual art degree. Trite. Contrived. Mediocre. Milquetoast. Amateurish, infantile, cliche and gonorrhea ridden.
Yes, we heard this last time. Where are we? We're halfway. We're at 50. Is there any point to wearing the hat? Plus one reaction speed, minus one rhetoric. No. There we go. Leading intellectual organ of Martinet's communism offers a radical Mazovian perspective on a range of contemporary issues. The cover features a stylized portrait of the late King Frissell with a pair of white antlers growing out of his head. So wait, where's the ID card that I just got? What's so special about the borscht the strikers are eating? The cook in the whirling rags is making it. You can find him in the kitchen. Look into it. Get the key to the weasel's door from Manana. All right. Let's see if we can make that roll.
Mr. Dubois, a pleasure as always. You don't have to sit down this time, since you've already sat on that chair.
Thank you.
Of course. Let us dispatch with the formalities. You call me Everard, I call you Harry.
That's what the Hanged Corpse called you. Harry.
So that's really my name, huh?
My God, so it's true. I didn't want to believe it, but you are a fantastic science fiction amnesiac cop, aren't you? What are the odds of that?
Quite a lot, actually.
I think the odds of that are very low.
It might be a good idea to hide your confusion. I mean, see what his game is first.
Yeah, my memory is fine. I'm just testing you.
So good to hear that, Harry. Apparently, my sources were wrong. However, if you did have a spot of memory trouble, I could help you out with my big fat folder.
Words flow like a river of honey from his lips. I guess word has already reached him. No matter. No harm done. It's just a brown folder. You can't make out what's written on it.
Are you trying to tell me you've gotten hold of some of our documents?
Lieutenant inspects Everard over his spectacles.
Mr. Kitsuragi, would you mind? Me and Harry are talking about his lost identity right now.
Don't just jump to the folder. That's not smart. Shows you're on the edge. Do some probing first.
All right. Let's go through it.
It's Harry. Harry Dubois.
You feel like a Dubois, but you don't feel like a Harry. Strange.
Wait, I thought you were Harry Dubois. I feel like a Dubois, but not quite like Harry. Something longer. That is not my name. My name is Raphael Cousteau. We'll play it a little bit smarter this time. I used the Cousteau line in the last stream, but I think we'll actually go with Inland Empire.
Sure, okay. You're Harold. Harmon. Haroldimus? But that's not what the record says. The record says Harry Dubois, a real man's name.
Harmon, huh? In the name of Harmon? Lieutenant covers his face and sighs audibly.
Mr. Kitsuragi doesn't seem even slightly empathetic to your memory loss, Harry. I, however, wish to help you any way I can.
Do you know anything about my family? Do I have a wife or kids or...
Family? Harry, you're not a family man. There's not one peep of family in here. Unless you think you're a family man. Do you strike yourself as a family man, Harry?
You know what? Never mind the family.
Family, Harry, is the most important thing in the world.
What kind of cop does it say I am?
Harry, you're not simply a cop. You're a star. A bright, shining star in the drab law enforcement sky, outshining all other stars. You're a superstar.
That's what I like about you, Everard. You get me. Because this Harry totally believes he is a star.
Of course I do, Harry. And I'm gonna help you shine. I'm gonna put you on all the big stages, your name in giant neon letters. Harry Dubois.
The giant neon sign reading Harry Dubois, hanging from the Kvalsun crane, can be seen all the way to Jamrock. Somewhere in Mirova, a beautiful woman sees the bright glow on the horizon and says to herself, "Oh my God, I shouldn't have left him."
Where did you get that folder anyway, Everard?
This? My friends in your organization gave it to me, Harry.
This translates into, "Haha, you guys are so corrupt."
I find that very suspicious. May I have a look?
I'm afraid this is meant for union eyes only, Mr. Kitsuragi. I'm sure you understand. Please continue, Harry.
Let's talk about other matters.
Of course, Harry, of course. Let's not linger on personal details and amnesia. You wanted something from me.
No,
see
we wanna...
See you soon, Debardeur. Just kidding, but not too much.
We wanna make sure that we get that role this time.
Mr. Dubois. Let's hear it, Harry.
As you look at the folder, Everard covers it with his hand and pets it. He's hiding it from you because it's not a real RCM folder. It's just another one of those brown folders you saw in the file cabinet.
That's not an RCM folder.
Okay, Harry, you got me. This is from the Census Bureau, not the RCM. Those Census Bureau people are absolutely corrupt. You should do something about them.
He got the name from the Census Bureau, and everything else from your actions here in Martinez.
Yes, yes, Mr. Kitsuragi, from the Census Bureau. Like I said, now I'm actually a very busy man, so is there anything else I can do for you, Harry?
That means he doesn't really know anything about you.
That's what I thought.
A pity. The mystery of you will have to remain a mystery for the time being.
So the Census Bureau says my name is Harry Dubois.
Yes, that's what I said. Try to keep up, okay? Let's move on.
See if I can actually... You know what? We are going to exhaust the dialogue options. See if there are any other roles I can get that I failed from last time.
You don't have to sit down this time. Yes, your lost gun. My best men are on it. They're turning every stone, searching every playground, asking kids, grandmas, everyone. Your gun will be found, Harry. Let me assure you of that. It's just a matter of time and effort.
The only way to find it seems to be working with him. He might even be holding your gun hostage.
Hold on. Could he really hold my gun hostage?
Who knows? Only one thing is certain. If you work with him, you're going to get it back. And working with him might be the only way to do it.
Wait, my gun may... Oh, right. We tell that to him. I will not be blackmailed with this gun business.
Harry, Harry! I was only trying to be tactful. A lost gun is a dangerous thing. I can't have it around in my neighborhood. Kids could be playing gun roulette with it as we speak. Teenage gangs could be arming themselves. Get a hold of yourself, Harry.
I assure you, we are working on locating the missing sidearm as well.
The lieutenant is concerned about the lost gun and feels that the fact you haven't prioritized looking for it is unfortunate, if inevitable, and doesn't put the RCM in a good light.
Excellent, Mr. Kitsuragi. That's excellent news. Looks like we have a friendly gun-finding competition on our hands.
Yeah, sure, let's go for it.
Oh, that's very nice. I haven't gotten around to her yet. I'm very, very busy, you see. I hope you're getting along.
We are, for the most part.
One thing I want to make very clear, Harry, is that this is not some kind of union versus corporation situation. Everyone is just pals here.
Just pals?
We're all trying to do what's best for Martinez. Don't feel like you can't cooperate with her because you and I are such good friends and I'm helping you find your lost gun. I'm not a jealous guy.
Well, Joyce seems to think the union is lowballing her.
Yes, yes. Lowballing, of course. This isn't a casino, Harry. Real people, real livelihoods are at stake here. But everything's a casino for those rich types.
His expression makes it clear. This is childish and irresponsible behavior.
So why haven't you let her in to see you?
If she actually wants to see me, she will find a way. Any good negotiator would. And I just don't have anything to discuss with a bad negotiator.
He doesn't want to see her. It's as simple as that.
Mm-hmm. What happened to the previous negotiator, Mr. Gomal?
What do you mean, Harry? Nothing. I let him go.
He made concessions for the company in previous negotiations. Why would you let an ally like that go?
He's an old man, Harry. I wanted him to spend more time with his family. God knows how long he's got left.
You called him a midget.
Harry, I have little people in my organization. I would never call someone a midget. What is this? Honestly, I'm beginning to think you're a midget, Harry. I'm only kidding, Harry. You're not a midget. No one is. We're pals.
Joyce said the previous Union leader vanished under suspicious circumstances.
Vanished? Harry, the woman left her casserole in the oven and couldn't make it here in time for the voting.
Sure.
Oh, did I leave my casserole on? Better go home and check. The election can wait. When she got back, the whole thing was over.
Wait, there was no mention of a casserole from Joyce.
Funny, Joyce didn't mention any casserole.
Harry, Harry, Harry. Do not fixate on this little matter. Maybe it was a rabbit stew, or a hairdryer, or an iron. The point is, her heart wasn't in it. Mine was.
That much is true. His heart truly is in it, though you wouldn't think so by looking at him. This particular brand of humor he has, it makes for a fine distraction.
I like that conceptualization is now giving me 10 experience and healing my morale every time it goes off.
Of course, Harry. Let me just assure you one more time. It's perfectly okay to share anything we discuss here with this Joyce. This is a completely transparent organization. I have no interest in what she is doing, but I myself have nothing to hide. Your business is your business, and I respect your privacy. Just remember, none of this is secret. Tell her about all of it. My brother's picture, my singing swordfish clock. Tell her how overweight I am and how I'm helping you find your lost gun. Tell her about everything. Everard doesn't mind.
It is rather interesting to tell people things about each other, isn't it? It was nice telling him about her right now.
All right. Yes. That's all I had to do last time. But I'm actually kind of glad I got to redo that conversation, because that did actually go a lot better than the first time around. Okay. Time to get out of here. I think I'll stop by that crane one more time first, though.
Drawer has not lessened since you were last here. If anything, it seems to have grown slightly.
I like that. Thank you. Cap's doing again? Electric chemistry versus half-light. Okay. There. Opened up quite a little bit of this here area now. What do you have to say for yourself now?
The unpromising wise pupil returns. There is nothing funky about them. I cannot possibly imagine.
Okay. Well, let's go stop by Maniana.
So, how'd you like our harbor?
You've been in there, he means. Talked to the boss man, too, probably.
Labor Utopia.
It's but a rest area on the path leading across open plains.
He notes solemnly and then turns to you, a wide smile adorning his face.
Right. You talk to the boss, eye to eye, like men of the plain. If you have any more questions, I'm set to talk.
Well, you have any idea who killed the hangman?
The mercenary, eh? Who could have killed him? That's indeed the question. Why even do such a thing?
Shakes his head solemnly. The Merc was hanged with a very specific type of cargo belt, one often used in heavy transport areas, for example, harbors. The harbor is a prime area of suspicion. In your opinion, are the dock workers involved in the killing? We'll do the first one first.
What a thought! Why would noble workers resort to such a thing? Unless they were pushed, of course.
Pushed how?
Your dead guy was an enemy combatant.
Hold up. What does that mean?
He was an agent of the opposition, attempting to undermine our honorable efforts.
Did you kill him? I don't want to ask him that. We know he didn't. Oh well.
I ain't the murdering type, but that's just me. Large organizations like our union have all sorts of men, with all sorts of skills.
Sure, let's throw more into our rhetoric.
Understood. This has been of limited use. Still, thank you.
No problem. I wish the best to you in your search. Sure, I'm glad it's not my search.
Takes a sip from his flask. Everard said you have a key to a door.
A key, huh? What door is this key supposed to open?
Said it belonged to a weasel.
Oh, say no more. I got you.
Taps the side of his nose with a little wink.
I got that key right here. And let me tell you, it's mighty good of you to help us out during the strike. Working class solidarity, as they say.
Saw an opportunity and I took it. I'm a hustle grinder. I heard something about a weasel, and it didn't sound like a local polar weasel, if you know what I mean. Wink. I'm not opening this door for myself. I'm opening it for all working men. Not really doing this for political reasons. I like the second one.
Polar weasel? Oh. I know what you mean. I'm pretty sure he's actually Occidental, though. So you're going to be committing fratricide, my racist friend.
I didn't know that was a racial slur. I thought it was a reference to the polar bear thing.
What you're looking for is a basement door behind the greenhouse. That's behind the wailing in rags. That's all I know. Our organization is what you call compartmentalized. Means we keep out of each other's business.
Okay, but where did you get the key from?
The janitor gave it to me. Nice fella. We talked about life and things that really, truly matter.
That kind of sucks.
None of this mess we're in. This jiving and juggling. What's it for? To feed our children, I guess.
I really didn't think that was, like, gonna be a fascist response. I thought that was, like, a reference to the polar bear thing, because it was a basement key. God damn it. Anything else I should know about this task? This weasel person? When he'll be home?
I'm more of a philosophical dock worker. I like to talk about the big picture stuff. Who I am, who you are, what we are fighting for.
Takes big sip from his flask.
He means he's not going to tell you, cause he doesn't know. But he will shoot his mouth off with you now that you're working for Everhart. Who he is, and what they're fighting for. This is interesting.
Why are you striking?
We're negotiating our share.
Your share?
Aye.
Wait, so not wages or pensions or... How large a share would you like? Oh, okay, economy stuff, I get it. I want to talk about something else.
This stuff. They already covered.
Shouldn't you be grateful then? It's a lot more than most people here have. At least you got the benefits. That's something. However much you feed the wolf.
The wolf always wants more. I like wolves.
So how large of a share would you like?
All of it. However, right now we want all the harbor workers to be on the company's board, so they could take part in the decision-making process.
This seditious talk sounds like communism. Just so we're on the same page. Communism is basically wanting to kill the rich people or deporting them to a labor camp in Southeast Grad. But don't say that out loud if you're a communist.
So the boss man Everhart, what can you tell me about him?
I think it's best you make up your own mind now that you've met him. In my eyes, he is a capable organizer and a decent businessman.
What does bossing the union entail, anyway?
I guess you kind of get to be the village chief. He oversees the harbor, makes deals with the owners or other relevant parties. Watches out for his own.
By that, you mean corruption?
By heavens, why would it not be corrupt? We live in a harsh and disordered world, see? And in this world, the old man is corrupt for our benefit, and we know it. Appreciate it, even. He is, personally, not too lavish.
I don't know, that desk seemed lavish to me.
He is reasonably lavish, sure. That's his prerogative. It's not like you want a saintly demeanor on a corrupt motherfucker. That would be a manipulative illusion. Besides, there are no non-corrupt systems in the world anyway. And moralism is the most corrupt of them all.
Not you, you would like to say. But then there's that weasel door. This man has political theory, and it has not failed him today.
So are you a communist then, Manana? Obviously he is.
No.
No?
I don't think I'm a communist. Seeing something of value and saying I want it all to myself is a much older and simpler notion. No science to it at all. Even a weak child can think it. The only things holding someone back are I can't and I shouldn't.
Shouldn't take what's not yours. Cool, don't have anything to add to that. Right on, brother.
Just the way the war works, boyadero.
Seem to have spent a lot of time thinking about the political situation.
Sure. I've had the necessary free time. Fortunately, there's always time.
The look in his brown eyes conjures up an understanding. For him, having command of his time is the most important thing. It all comes together now. The way he speaks about scabs, his general attitude. He's a follower of a 500-year-old Franco-Nigerian Boyadero code, itself an appropriation of Vespertine cool. That of a noble peasant or a traveling herdsman. True to yourself, independent in your actions, loyal to your friends.
Doesn't sound that cool. Sounds antiquated, obsolete, passé. It's not disco. Maybe I am a boyadero. See, me personally, I kind of dig Manana's philosophies there, but old Harry. Harry likes the disco. That's as Joyce kind of rolled with it, like that. That really is kind of, I guess, the neoliberalist response. Oh, no. Overall, it's good philosophy.
No.
But...
No. The man sits on the railing, his hands reaching far and wide. Yet it feels as if he could, effortlessly, go even wider, if need be. An endless torrent of time.
Actually, do you know anything about the Hardy Boys, Manana?
Los Ardis? They're an independent militant group. A bit too high-strung, but it comes with the responsibility. They're sort of like you. Preserve the rule of law and all that. Except it's Everard's law. But really, they're just like you.
Is he actually comparing you, an officer of the law, to some neighborhood vigilantes? Come on. He's just trying to keep the peace.
There's only one law, friend, and that's me.
Why not? Must be nice being something else for a change. The rest of us are just folks.
Very well. Yeah, I like my white jacket. It suits me.
Right to work! Right to work! Shame on you!
Right.
Looking for something?
You could push him by asking him to show you the soles of his boots. He definitely looks like someone capable of a lynching.
Let's see the soles of your boots.
Been admiring the stompers, huh? Sure thing. Check them out.
Lifts his left foot, then his right.
On the bottom of the man's boots, you see an intricate tangle of treads with no immediately discernible pattern.
What's up with your soles?
It's Revachol.
But where did you get boots like that?
Custom made. Cost me a pretty penny.
But why?
For when the invasion comes, the last thing they'll see before the lights go out is illustrious Revachol.
Fucking skinheads.
It doesn't look like the lieutenant cares. He just makes a little note.
What is this invasion anyway? Sounds like more immigrant bashing. You do understand you're stomping on Revachol every day, don't you?
No, it's not like that. You don't get it. It's when I kick them, you know? Oh, fuck it. It's too complex for you.
No. We get it.
It's about biological determinism, natural law, the sorting of the races. Not the most popular topic nowadays, with a coalition in charge and all. You might want to change the topic. That is, bury your head under the sand like common sheep.
So you're just a racist. Makes sense.
I'm not just racist. Look, I've read books, huh? The science of racial theory has all been proved. Even if some people don't want to accept it.
I still have not put that thought in my head, and I'm not going to.
People who've studied these things say that you and me are superior by design. So, naturally, we Occidentals should be in charge. Obviously, you can see the merits in that.
Race is a simplistic means of social classification based on easily observed attributes, hunches, and pseudoscience.
Yes, I can really tell you're a prime example of superior design. You just look at people and make arbitrary judgments. See, I'm afraid that he's not going to say that sarcastically if I pick that. Otherwise, like, I would have picked that right away.
The lieutenant tries to remain impassive, but the slight arch of his eyebrow tells you that he's liking it.
As arbitrary as any judgment, that doesn't make it less of a fact. We'll have to use facts. Huh? Once you accept it, you'll gain the clarity of understanding.
Yeah, well, I've already made up my mind. You want to hear it?
Oh? Don't push your luck, runt.
Man gives you a disgusted look, then turns his attention elsewhere, ignoring your presence.
Looking for something, runt? Come to tell me to fuck off again?
No. You're gonna tell me what's up with the lady driver.
I don't know what you're talking about.
First, you knew Siling didn't do it.
He did something. He stole his employer's goods and another lorryman's job. You should be thankful for the tip.
He's been expecting this. He's really puffed himself up.
Then why are you smirking?
Listen up, fuckwits. You don't scare me. You cops don't run Revachol West. You don't run Martinez. You don't run anything.
Actually, we do.
No, he means la puta madre.
A legendary, and not in a good way, crime boss from Jamrock, controls what is probably the most powerful organized crime outfit in Revachol West. Looks like the lieutenant has a plan. Let him do this.
Yeah, him.
Cross your arms and nod.
Then I presume you are familiar with his peonies.
Yeah, they're his little bitches. He's got them all over the unions.
Not just the unions. He has peonies everywhere. Some say he even has them in the RCM. Dirty fucking peonies who do anything for him. Multi-ethnic drug addicts.
I like where this is going.
You're not peonies. You wouldn't be investigating a drug thing if you were.
No, of course not. We are not peonies. But if we were, and one of Madre's drivers were to be stealing from him, then it's a good peonies job to find out who that is. It's not a hard job. It won't take a long time. It won't make Padre Madre angry. But a stupid fucking racist is standing in the way, protecting this fucking thief.
I'm not scared of you or the mob. I'm under the protection of the Lorryman and Carter's Guild.
You've seen that corpse in the ceramic armor there. Did his shitty little guild protect him?
Nah, you wouldn't just leave him out there if you...
Tries to light a fresh cigarette, but his hands are shaking now. Sentence simply ends.
The lieutenant turns and gives you a barely perceptible nod. I softened him up as best I could. Now it's on you to finish the job.
Fuck. Where are my other gloves? This one, half light. Get my ass a little drunk. Let's see how this works.
Looking for something odd? Come to tell me to fuck off again?
Alright, well, I can save scum this, but we're gonna get him to tell us.
Men like this only respect two things: strength and fear. Time to turn up the volume.
Show me her lorry right fucking now. That lady driver's lorry. Where is it?
Fuck you. I told you. I'm not gonna...
There. His voice grows smaller as yours.
I'm gonna fuck you up for the rest of my life. You understand? Oh, I'm gonna fuck you for the rest of my life. I'm gonna put you in a cell with a giant kipped. You're gonna be bleeding kip dick. Do you hear me? I've been to your fucking lorry. I know where it is. I'm gonna burn it down. You hear me? What's your name, fuckhead? I'm gonna go on police radio saying this guy told Madre to fuck off. I think that's the best one to go with. Get him right in his racist fear.
Look, fuck you, man. It's some lorry down there. Green, banged up thing. I don't fucking know who she is.
When did she go away?
I don't know. I don't even know her name. She just rolls with the fleet and acts like a big shot. Some dyke, probably. I haven't even seen her for days.
Now it's not a big deal for him anymore. This is how he saves face.
Where exactly is her lorry?
Past the monument, down there. The Green Temple. Now leave me the fuck alone, okay?
A small temple by the monument. Green, let's get into that lorry.
All right, I'm going. Sweet. Here we are.
This green fowl, A to Z, contemporain, is parked in the shadow of the ruins looming overhead. It's seen better days.
This must be the one he told us about, unless he was lying.
Lieutenant peeks inside. Try to peek in the window.
The glass on the side windows is tinted and covered with dust. You can barely make out the shape of a seat and two steering levers. The door is locked. The handle looks shiny, like it's recently replaced.
How are we going to get this open, Kim?
Use the pry bar to smash the window. Open it from the inside.
Good idea.
I don't know how good it is, but this investigation has taken long enough. We can't afford it to take any longer.
This green fowl, A to Z, contemporain, is parked in the shadow of the ruins looming overhead.
Oh, I already have the physical instrument one on, and I'm drunk. And it's still that low? Okay.
This green fowl, A to Z,
with a firm grip, raise the pry bar. A glint of light catching on the tip. Call down the hammer of truth and justice. Release your secrets, lorry cabin.
Say fuck the police, then smash it. Say welcome to Revachol, window, and then smash it. I'm sorry. Smash it apologetically. Sure, we'll apologize to the window.
The window shatters,
and droplets of glass fly everywhere, shattering over the lorry floor and pavement.
Sato.
Says the lieutenant and sticks his hand in the window like a common car thief and opens
the
it.
The smell of cigarettes and perfume welcomes you. The cabin inside is plastered with old movie posters. Actresses smile from the walls. There's a radio transmitter in the front and a toolbox tucked under the driver's seat. Some tools lie scattered near the pedals. There's something odd about the passenger seat. The seating fabric has been pulled tight over the lower side of the seat where the toolbox should be. These are movie posters featuring starlets from long-forgotten films from the 20s, the teens, even the 90s of the last century. One of them particularly catches your eye, a centerfold of an ingenue attached right above the back seat. There's definitely perfume in the air. It's spicy, with a hint of amberette, wafting through the bitter air of the cabin.
Stop and wonder what's that smell.
The remnants of a sweet juniper-scented perfume. Probably grenade number 5.
Study the centerfold.
The actress is draped in a sheath dress, one of her shoulders bared. The faded remains of an autograph run across the poster. She's looking past the camera. Wait, doesn't she resemble someone you know? But you can't put your finger on whom exactly. This is Tip Tijon, a starlet from the dawn of cinematography, less known for her talent than her tragic, untimely death.
What happened to her?
She wasted away in a drug den called the Door to the River, not far from here on Boogie Street. A mixture of cocaine and morphine. She was afraid of the world and the camera, too.
Enough of
the actresses and the rear actor all smile you a warm goodbye. A radio transmitter is attached to the dashboard, and a toolbox sits under the driver's seat. A metallic drawer slides out from the seat. It's empty, except for a folded newspaper. It's an issue of Periferique from last Wednesday. A piece of paper falls out from its pages. It looks like an article ripped out from a radio enthusiast magazine. Complex mathematical equations explain the basics of something called the ULAN frequency system.
The ULAN frequency system? I've never heard of that before. I know of FM, AM, UKV, but...
His thought trails off.
Pull out toolbox slides back into its nest. The rest is as it was. Posters, a radio, dust on the windows. You wedge yourself under the steering wheel to get a better look. Seems like the few tools lying around here, a hammer, a pair of pliers, a rusty wrench, have been casually thrown there by the disorganized driver. But one odd detail does catch your eye. A piece of sandpaper has been glued to the throttle. Sandpaper adds extra grip.
Looks like the driver has glued a piece of sandpaper to the throttle to offer some extra grip.
Sandpaper? A novel technique?
Sandpaper would also rub off the pattern from the driver's right boot sole.
Yes?
He likes where this is going.
Do the honors, he thinks. Connect it yourself.
One of the footprints at the crime scene had an aberration. One sole was smoother than the other.
Which means that the missing lady driver was present at the lynching.
Wait. The missing 8th Hardy? Here? And she was also the one running the drug trade. What a handful. First the drug smuggling and now this. How deep does this rabbit hole go? Women. Always up to something.
Now we know for certain who's the missing 8th person at the lynching. Do you think that Hardy and his boys could also be involved in the drug operation?
I think the entire union is involved. Maybe even all of Martinez.
We should talk with Titus, see what he's got to say on the matter. Are we finished with the lorry?
No, we're not.
The movie stars are still smiling from the walls. The radio transmitter sits on the center console, and a faint smell of perfume is in the air. Looks like the frequency dial is absent. It requires a key to work, but the key has been removed, likely by the missing lady driver.
Strange. There are so many radio stations saved here. Must be over 100 at least.
Why would anyone need so many radio stations? Is there anything we can do with the radio?
Doesn't look like it. It's completely inoperable without the dial key. For contacting an entire fleet of lorrymen, for example. This is all shortwave, UW and UKV. Looks like we are dealing with an impressive organizational tool. The nerve center of a huge operation. With quite a range, too.
The ghostly actresses and the rusty toolbox under the driver's seat and the oddly bulging seat cover. Voila, a stack of neatly folded papers has been stashed behind the seating fabric. You see three maps depicting a large metropolitan area. It's Revachol. Some of its routes and highways have been outlined with a pen.
Do I get to keep one of these maps?
Bonne prise.
Lieutenant commends you as you shift through the treasure, well-worn and folded into neat squares.
This large map displays the elevated motorway called 881. The intake leading to Martinez is marked with a blue X. There's another X on the off-ramp at a place called the Old South. Toll booths at the intakes are marked with a circle. It looks like there are scant few ways of getting onto the elevated motorway that runs over Jamrock. And this person knows them all. There, hundreds of thousands of motor carriages roar on the 881. High above the mess of brown and red roofs, that is Jamrock. The commuters don't even look down. The world ceases to exist outside the windshield.
Where does the road lead?
To Kuron, through the middle-income neighborhoods there, by the river, and then to Stella Maris and La Delta for work, while the men and women of Jamrock scuttle to their fates below the road. This municipal map from the 30s displays a complex system of storm sewers underneath a sub-district called the Pox, old military hospital, right adjacent to the 41st precinct. No storm will ever drown Revachol, the great solution to the riddle of history. The final map displays a labyrinth of service tunnels left over from the construction of motorway 881. A few routes have been marked with a pen, where the tunnels and sewers surface near the eminent domain and a traffic island in central Jamrock by the lake.
What does all this mean?
It means that the smugglers are secretly using the motorway to transport their goods and materials. They've infiltrated East Motor Tract, most likely. The RCM patrols most of these auxiliary roads, though apparently not all of them.
Where's the contraband end up?
Hard to say. This distribution network looks certainly large, yet still vague enough. It doesn't reveal much about the Besmerti behind it.
Besmerti? It sounds vaguely familiar.
The Besmerti is a Revacholian crime syndicate. They see themselves as the inheritors of the 14 Revacholian Indo-tribes. But really, they're just violent gangs vying for control on the west side of Revachol. With cool names, like La Puta Madre and Aura Masta, it's a dark parody.
So who do you think is behind this?
It's definitely not the Union. They just do some logistics. This operation has spread everywhere in Jamrock. If it's that widespread, then Madre remains the most likely suspect. Here's bad news. There have been attempts at a serious investigation before, but they haven't ended well for those involved.
Especially bad news for cops who may have something in their past they don't even know is there.
Good to know.
Best not to disturb the scene. I'll have forensics go over the lorry and pick this up later.
The stack of maps looks just like before, barely noticeable. The movie stars look silently by, and the pull-out toolbox has a rubber handle, worn from years of use. You close the rusty old lorry door.
Great. I think we got everything. A word, Detective? Before we return to Joyce? All right, we've finished here. Let's quickly debrief and go over what we found, so we don't do it in front of the company rep.
Seems like something police could do. What do you think of all this, Kim?
Honestly, I'm quite worried by what we've seen so far. The evidence seems to point to a rather extensive and well-organized operation. I'm especially intrigued by that radio transmitter, particularly the sheer number of stations it can connect. Looks like this alleged drug trade casts a wide net. I'm not sure what the Yulan frequencies are all about, but they may hold some significance. Perhaps it's a better way to connect between fleets while avoiding frequency bleed, or maybe it's used to tap into RCM networks.
Listening in on your calls between you and your station? A worrying prospect.
Oh, and the maps we found. They reveal the geographical extent of the operation. Looks like they've used abandoned tunnels and access roads to stay hidden. This is useful info. And last but not least, it looks like the Hardy boys knew this driver, as we know that she was present at the lynching. This may be the union connection we've been searching for.
The probe and the case converged, he thinks. This was quite the find.
So it turns out this is connected to the union.
Like Joyce told us, yes, logistically. But don't expect to bust this open during our stay here. At best, this is an angle we can use against them, to other ends, as extra ammunition.
Will the RCM open an investigation into this?
We should return to the murder case, see what Joyce tells us about the lynching. When we are done for the day, I call my station and suggest our narcotics department look into it. There are more than enough grounds to start an official investigation, sometime later when we are done here. We do not want to get caught in that.
Stops to think. What are you thinking, Kim?
The fact that one hasn't started already gives me pause. An investigation, I mean. Especially if the Madre grouping is involved, and I can't imagine they aren't. It's certainly worrisome.
Corruption?
All the same, I don't like the idea of internal affairs descending on the matter. That won't help anyone either.
And what about the movie posters? How do they factor into all this?
As elegant as they are, I don't think they are relevant to the drug trade.
Don't be fooled. Desire always plays a role.
A lot of women there, especially for a lady driver's cabin.
Yes, well.
He doesn't say more.
Unimportant.
As elegant.
Don't be fooled. Desire.
Yes, well.
Unimportant.
Debrief over. After you.
Well, there are a few more things that I think we're gonna do to finish this one off. I could use a little bit of extra money. Gonna sell those postcards finally.
Is this about the questions again? Because I don't really know anything.
The tear machine stands in the corner. Your bottles clunk into the machine. A small cabinet on the wall is filled with various medicine bottles, nasal sprays, and blister packs. They all...
Is this about the questions again? Because I don't really know...
No, I want to sell you some shit, but...
You see several packaged raincoats fill a low shelf beneath a... A colorful display...
Again, I'm obliged to inform you that both alcohol and cigarettes damage your health.
Wonder where I can sell those postcards. Oh, the pawn shop. Pawn shop. Go give these men their buhl back.
We're still waiting for a replacement for the bull you sent sinking.
Is there anything? I found you guys a new buhl.
What is this? Are you mocking us? This isn't for betonk.
Oh.
Now. No need to get angry again, René. I'm sure the officer tried his best. It's not like there's a bull kiosk here in Martinez.
Exactly. And I really did try.
Trying is worth as much as is accomplished. In this case, almost nothing. Fine. You tried to right a wrong. It's still a grand better than actual nothing.
Is there anything you can tell me about this rifle?
It's a Bell McGrave. 4.46 caliber. Breech loading. Revachol made. Good weapon. Accurate and reliable. This one's inoperable. The bolt spring is missing and the mechanism is jammed shut. Still a beauty. Where did you find her?
In the basement there.
I'm not surprised. There are probably lots of forgotten wartime weapons lying around here. Back in the day, everyone had something stashed away. As for the rifle, I don't know what else to tell you. These BM-446s are an antique. No one uses them anymore. The ammunition is impossible to find.
Well, I found your guard booth.
Yes. The Debardeur's union pays me to stand vigil during the night. Not out of any political allegiance, mind you. I'm an old man. Don't sleep more than a few hours every night anyway, and money is tight.
You must have seen something on the night of the murder. Your booth looks right onto the yard.
Yes, it does. Unfortunately, I wasn't working that night. Been on a 2-week leave since last Monday.
Hold on, why are you on a leave?
It's a private matter. Nothing to do with your investigation.
You see, officer, René is the kind of man would rather die than admit he needs medical assistance or, God forbid, seek it. A real man's man is just gonna ride it out.
I'm fine, goddammit. Mind your own business. It's nothing. Just got to cut back on coffee.
So who was working your shift that night?
No one. The booth has been unmanned since last Monday. There's no other guard. It's just me.
No one has been guarding the container yard since last Monday?
Yes. It's not actually an issue. I mean...
Look, officer. The container yard doesn't actually need a guardsman. Never had one before, René. Monsieur Claire had that booth built specially for him. It's mostly decorative.
Mostly decorative?
The possibility of someone being in there is enough to discourage any ill-minded individuals.
Evrard created this job for René because he knows the royal carabiner's pension of honor and PTSD isn't something a man can live off. A decorated Kingsman collecting tear reflects bad on the whole neighborhood. His world.
Evrard gets it. Big guys looking after the small and everyone working together. I love it. Such dependency only weakens a man further. Do or die, there is no middle ground. René is but one man. We need a program. Get all the elderly back in the job market. Keep folks motivated. René should rent out his services, invest the profit. Get a few more guys, expand and repeat. Wage work is a dead end. There's absolutely nothing wrong with tear collecting. It's my side thing too. Proudly holds out the tear bag.
Oh, I didn't mean to imply there's something wrong with that. I do it too. Everyone does it. It's an excellent side thing.
Gotta love side things.
Yes, yes, yes. Can we conclude the topic of my guard boost now?
He is not going to become an entrepreneur.
Yes, yes. Like I said, it would be up anyway, so might as well keep an eye out. It keeps my senses sharp.
Just out of curiosity.
Vigilance officer, what can this old carabiner do for you?
All you observe is a veteran refusing to let go of the past and is...
This is the uniform of the Royal Carabiniers in service of Frissel the First, Guillaume Le Lion, and the valiant King Philip the Fifth before him.
Don't you mean Frissel the Fan?
You do not speak his name, Craven, although he was a clown. But he was our clown. Ours to ridicule and to mourn.
There's something you missed. You will get to it. Don't worry.
Yeah, we're not gonna take that bit of morale damage. I think my next level I'm gonna put more into composure. Shop is down here. Do want to hit that up.
A couple of indicator lights are missing from this control panel. Loose wires dangle from the now vacant holes. In the middle is a lever. Beneath it, a small metal plaque. This panel usually closes the water lock, turning it into a bridge that lets you cross the canal. But there's a crashed Samarin butter sign in the way. Pulling the lever probably won't do anything. You pull the lever all the way up until the metal clicks against the contact pins. You hear a soft clunk. Then, nothing happens. Nothing happens. A cold gust of wind blowing in from the sea interrupts the silence of the situation. A spring brings the lever back to its original position. You still need to close the waterlock to get across the canal. Some other way.
Close the waterlock on Wednesday.
Wasn't there a sign over there saying functionality will be restored on Wednesday morning?
Good day to you, officers.
A burly man hangs out by the waterlock, carving up a generous serving of salami with an old hunter's knife. His eyes are fixed on a man stranded on the other side of the waterlock and on an enormous billboard that has fallen down into the canal between them. His posture is relaxed. Despite his powerful build and a knife in his hand, this man resorts to physical intimidation only infrequently, if at all.
First things first. What are you doing here, man on the waterlock?
My friend Barry the Butcher is stuck on the other side of the waterlock. I'm keeping him company and eating his salami.
From the corner of your eye, you see a man in a yellow shirt and gray overalls waving at you from across the canal. He seems disappointed about the wreckage on the waterlock and the salami.
Very good stuff. Anything I can do for you, officer?
The man on the waterlock picks the skin off a slice of salami and takes a sizable bite. Do you know what caused this wreckage?
I wasn't here to witness it, but those look like tire tracks on that sign. Weird, huh? Then again, plenty of daredevil drivers in Revachol.
The words daredevil driver sound ominous to you.
Too bad it also takes a year and a day to repair anything around here. Especially a waterlock. The rest of the coast is closed off till then.
What's with the lever that does nothing? Do you know what's further down the coast?
Well, there's the fishing village, an abandoned fish market, a bizarro church. Not much use to the congregation, though. There always seems to be something wrong with it.
Thinks for a moment.
Yeah, not really much else. Just bombed out ruins.
What's with the lever that does nothing?
It's supposed to operate the waterlock, but as noted, it's all junk right now. Disabled because of the blockage.
Why is it disabled?
Safety measure. Turns out the panel needs a special key to be reactivated. Wouldn't want anyone moving the waterlock with debris still in the channel. It'll be restarted on Wednesday morning. You want to do the honors when the time comes?
Do I ever?
Great. Just drop in on Wednesday if you want to see the waterlock at work. They say the canal crew will be here at 7:15.
Cuts fresh slice from a salami.
The coast part of the map is inaccessible until the third day.
Good to know.
There it is again. The scent of apricots with a touch of cinnamon. Smells like the end of some distant summer. The surface of another planet or some ancient temple. Bitter, citrus, sweet. It seems to grow stronger like a glow with every breath you take. Whatever petrochemical byproducts they used to create this artificial flavor have bonded tightly to the wrapper. Or is that just your memory filling the gaps, until a blossom of skin and flower petals erupts behind your closed eyes. Made of toffee, cream, and distance, you just had to take a dive. Feels so, so familiar. The sun sets into the sea, but the water does not boil. Instead, it turns to liquid gold. For a moment, the world's store of precious metals seems to increase dramatically. And you are rich. There is a movement next to you.
the shuffle of a small coat, warm like the evening. But when you turn toward it, there's nothing there.
Where did it go?
Why are you talking to a gum wrapper? Yes, from the height of antiquity, a long, long time ago, millennia ago, on an island of time you can never return to.
All right, well. Go sell these things, see if maybe the pawn shop owner does know anything more about my lost gun or the woman who apparently bought it. This.
Wow, a very large red t-shirt with an impressive print stands out from the other garb.
Oh yeah?
Oh yeah, the print depicts a muscled man striding toward you, a giant sword in each hand, encircled by burning embers. Behind him is a cluster of cabins engulfed in flames. Beneath him are the words, Heomdal burning.
Sniff the t-shirt.
Smells like worn cotton. And a little old sweat there. Worn cotton with a side of flea market or trash bin.
Sniffing is okay. But please don't try anything on. Can't have you leaving your photon emissions in the fabric of things you're not going to buy.
You're not imagining it. Photon emissions? What is he talking about? A typical Martinez streetlight sits among assorted floor and table lamps. The boomboxes wait on the shelves, and your boombox, that gold and amber Harmon Wauschi, stares at you longingly with its tape reel eyes.
What I really want to know is, could this device come in handy in my police work?
If police work means playing tapes, sure, you can use it for that. Or any other time you'd need to play a tape.
Like for karaoke.
You see rows of toy soldiers guarding the rest of the trinkets displayed on the table. Some on horseback, others in rags, others yet in bright blue uniforms. All are stern and unyielding in their duty. You see rows of toy soldiers guarding the rest of the trinket. Why? What's this? A headless man riding a horse. A headless man wearing futuristic tracksuit trousers that say Faun.
What is this?
Oh, that's the headless Faun rider.
Who?
The headless Faun rider. It's an urban legend about a man who rides the streets of Revachol sporting a Faun tracksuit. As you see, he's missing his head. 50 cents. Bargain price. I'll throw in the tiny cap too. I think he's looking for it, or something. That part of the story has many interpretations.
Yeah, sure, we'll get it. Why not?
Did I mention that this figurine is supposed to be lucky? Always carry it with you.
Well, that's nice.
Hello again. How can I help you?
Something I'd like to
sell. Let me have a look.
I've checked my pockets.
Anything else you're thinking of selling?
Yeah, I'll sell this. And that. And that. Gonna hang on to that. And I'll sell that postcard to you. I have a fascinating photo of a corpse here.
Oh, no. I don't like those kinds of objects. No sale.
Barely even looks at it. Do you know what the tattoos mean?
A photic path, counter-radiance network, anti-magnetism. It's darkness. That's all I know. Sell me something lighter.
You have absolutely no idea what a photic paths are, but the tattoos on the man are not that.
Another time, perhaps.
Wanted to ask about my missing gun again.
Sure thing.
People from Everett Clare's union come here to track that gun.
Maybe. Shady looking guys came in here yesterday, looking like they'd just taken off their Wild Pines overalls. They asked if I have a police weapon to sell. I told them I already sold it. They went their way. It was a trip. But you know, all sorts of people come here, asking for all sorts of things.
Maybe Claire really is tracking down your gun.
Sure, man.
Anything else give me extra electrochemistry? Yes.
Hello again. How can I help you?
Let's try it.
Feeling warm and enthralled by the movement of light, while the mind continues to race forward. Lucky bastard, he's probably on Perolidon. It's tough to come by on the street.
Perolidon? What's that? Getting lucky with my roles in this stream.
A drug developed by the military to treat and prevent radiation sickness. It has psychedelic side effects, and it makes your eyes turn yellow.
Is it just me, or is it really warm in here? Sir, could you take off your sunglasses? I'd like to check your eyes. So where does man get Perolian these days? Sure, we'll just get straight to the point on this.
How would I know?
Those triangle patches on his vest, you have a feeling they mean something, like they're similar to the halogen rectangle on your jacket.
It's pretty obvious that you're under the influence. No judgment, just curious. I probably did loads of Perolidon before I lost my memory. Chill out, man, chill. I'm a chill out cop who just wants some of what you're having.
I was with the emergency relief brigade. You know, after the People's Pile disaster.
Coughs as if to mark his words.
Had to take Perolidon for radiation sickness. That's what you were hinting at just now, wasn't it?
He's taken it for mental and emotional, not physical pain these days.
What was the People's Pile?
A bad idea. Some poor leftist built a particle decay generator in hopes of bringing affordable electricity to underserved communities. It malfunctioned. Radioactive waste everywhere. Probably some of it in you, too.
Tell me more about this emergency relief brigade you were part of.
We were an all-volunteer force. Self-organized. Tried to help the fire brigades contain the spill.
On the patch, gamma radiation lines crossed with a red drop of blood.
I lived by the river since I was a small boy. The Esperance. Didn't have the art to let it all go to shit without trying to do something to help out. There wasn't much the volunteer force could do, however. We wasted years in the river mud. Years getting sick.
He looks at the spiraling light and stops. Must have been tough. Radioactive cleanup.
There's a reason why everyone's tried to forget any of it ever happened. And why no one has tried to repair or replace the pile. So much disappointment. An early death. Cancer, mostly. And we knew all that was coming, even as we were cleaning up as best we could.
Whose fault was it that the generator failed?
No one's. Everyone's.
Shakes his head and sighs.
So much bitterness.
A bunch of poor people built themselves a primitive nuclear reactor, hoping for the best. What do you think is going to happen?
So how did you end up running this pawn shop, then?
The cleanup happened 15 years ago. I was young then. Later, my second aunt died. Left me this shack and all the assorted junk in it. So I came to Martinez. People told me don't go there. It's a shithole. I said, people, we just had a nuclear pile meltdown. I'm gonna get as far away from Forberg as I can. Still in the same city, but...
Shrugs. Well, thank you for telling me.
I like the theory more than the story. Outward movement, not vortices.
Yeah, you gotta get in on those vortices, my man.
Care to share your Pyrolodon with me?
Have you tried it before?
The lieutenant steps away, pretending to admire some of the knickknacks on display. Looks like he doesn't want to get involved. Go ahead then, he thinks. As long as you can walk straight, I don't care. He won't be your nog, but he won't be thrilled about this either.
I think I've tried it once, and I liked it.
Here you go, man.
Presents a large cap-shaped object on the palm of his hand. Very odd looking.
Yes, darling. That's the coalition government ordained Pyrolodon. Straight into your gut.
Thanks, man.
Of course.
All right. So we've actually done quite a bit of successful stuff in this stream. We got a little bit more information on the drug trade quest. We had a... I'd actually say that interaction with Everard Claire went way better than the one from the last stream. We gave those guys back their bull, even though it wasn't the right bull. And, yeah. Know a little bit more about our gun. Now we have a bunch of other things we can do. We can go see if we can do more about trying to find that missing gun. We can also talk to Joyce. But before I talk to Joyce, I'm gonna go talk to Elizabeth and the Hardys. We also have this door thing that we can open there as well.
Just an ordinary wall. Nothing to see here.
I wonder. Let's see. Maybe we can do this impossible roll.
You have no clue. It's just a wall. So many walls all over Martinez. Weather worn, cracked, their paint peeling.
Well, we can always try it a bit later if we get our conceptualization up a little bit more. But I think that's all for another stream. Because we still have those guys to talk to. Actually, you know what? We may as well start next stream by busting into this guy's apartment, not doing what Everard said. We're actually going to go in and check it out. And then interrogate those Hardys further, and then go follow up with Joyce. And thank you very much for all of you who tuned in to kind of lurk and watch and join me tonight. As always, it's a pleasure to have you all with me. And we'll be doing more Disco Elysium tomorrow. And Wednesday, we are going to be coming back with some Souls. And until then, y'all stay safe. You have a good night. Stay warm and inside, because it's getting cold outside. And I'll see y'all next stream. Good night.